Thank you. Assalamu alaikum, all of you. A very good morning of all are there. I hope you are aware of the happenings, what's going on today in India. Assalamu alaikum. Because of some technical problem, I have to address you again and again. A very good morning. I hope that you people are aware of what is going on in India. And due to that, our schedule got a little bit disturbed today due to Bharat Band, that the entire India stands with our farmers. But the thing is that we people thought first to cancel this, but later, since we people are educators or we people belongs to education department, and we thought that our priority is to build the nation for the future. That's the reason we have decided to continue our induction program, because you people are the future of this India, future of the world also. Because we people are preparing you for the world as a contributor. Thus, to be ignore what is happening and concentrating on building nation, I would like to begin today's session. As I have already made announcements that this week, all sessions are dedicated to subject related aspects. Those subjects which you people are going to have in your first year, and how it is connected, these all subjects connected to your engineering in upcoming year's syllabus. So today is dedicated to chemistry department and mechanical department. So let's begin with the chemistry. We are going to have an introduction about the chemistry department and its related aspects as a subject to engineering. And that will be presented by Dr. Rehana Anjum, the head of the Department of Chemistry, Sciences and Humanities Department. She is the ex-principal of Farha Engineering College, which is a cousin of Lord Sister of Engineering and Technology, is a professor in the Department of Sciences and Humanities at Lord Sister of Engineering and Technology. She has more than 20 years of teaching experience and around 12 years of teaching experience of nations, multinationals, and international students. She has two bachelor's and two master's degrees in two different fields of education, such as engineering as well as education department. In 2010, she has been awarded with PhD from Dr. BAMU. She has been awarded with PhD from Dr. BAMU, Aurangabad University. She has published papers in international and national journals, participated and presented papers in national conferences. She is a member of AIITEC and IIST, that is Indian Institute of Science and Technology. Her areas of interest are multiple intelligence, retention, green chemistry, hydrocyclic compound, and working on different ways of preparing solvent free and eco-friendly reaction. As you have seen that she is the combination of both chemistry expertise she has already, plus she has a very good background of education. That means how a child is supposed to be reared in an education institution. So with this note, I would like to request Dr. Rehana Anjum, the head of the Department of Chemistry, to address the gathering. Thank you.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuhu. A very good morning to all dear students and respected parents. It's my privilege to welcome you all at Lords Institute of Engineering and Technology. I hope since last 2 weeks you have been acquiring knowledge of various subjects related to engineering. I am here to assist you to understand how the subject of chemistry is associated, how the subject of chemistry is associated with engineering and its applications. I would like to introduce first the entire team of chemistry department. First and the foremost, Dr. Mohammad Samir Ahmed. He is MSc from Osmania University and PhD from King Abdulaziz University, Kingdom of Saudi Arabia. He has 5 years of experience. Second, Anjum Afroz, she is MSc Chemistry, has 24 years of experience and presently working on carcinogenic compound. Next comes Anjum Begum. She is MSc B.Ed, 7 years of experience. Presently, she is working on, or her area of interest is analytical chemistry. And the last one is G. Radhika, MSc Chemistry, assistant professor. She has an experience of 3 years. Now today, I am here to explore the chemistry through my PPT, means how the chemistry is important in everyday life. And before that one, first of all, let me introduce that how the chemistry plays an important role in our daily life and why the chemistry is important in every branch of engineering. As we know that, we have the different branches, starting from the CSC, IT, EEE, ECE. Now we have introduced the two new branches, CSD and CSMIL. Now let me go through all the PPTs and you also get to know that why and how the chemistry is important. Okay. Now the first and foremost thing is there, what is chemistry? I can say that the branch of chemistry is the branch of science concerned with the substance of matter is composed of investigation of the properties and reaction and use of such reactions to form a new substance. In short, I can say whenever and whatever we are doing is nothing but the reaction or the outcomes of chemistry. Every material exists is made up of matter, even though if you think of our body, think of different reactions which are going out in and out of our body, excretion, circulation, every material exists is made up of matter. If you think of our body also, whatever the reactions are going out in and out, I can say it is due to because of the chemistry only. Either we are breathing, either we are excreting or whatever the, we can say that the circulation system is going on, it is all the byproduct of chemistry only. The hormonal changes which are going on because of the chemistry, we can say that whatever the substance are present, whatever the chemical substance are present in our body, whatever the digestion of the food process is going on, it is also due to the, because of that chemistry only. Now, everything that has been created by engineer is composed of chemicals. Chemistry is the study of chemicals. Chemistry, you can say that the chemist is the magician who can turn waste products into the things both beautiful and useful. Engineering chemistry is taught as a compulsory subject to first year students to all branches of engineering. The engineering syllabus enlists the topics from the branches, which is included, means we can say that the, all the branches it covers. I can name here the inorganic chemistry, physical chemistry, organic chemistry, material chemistry, and now they introduce the green chemistry and so on. Step by step, we will see significance of chemistry. Chemistry is relevant to every walk of our life. Chemistry needed everywhere in the life. Without the chemical reaction, there is no single movement in life. Chemistry for the first year forms a bridge between basic sciences and engineering subjects. First of all, just see why the chemistry is important to CSC and IT students. Now we know that research is the main area, you can say, if you want to develop something, if you want to innovate something, the research is there. For doing that research, I can say, the different software is acquired to interpret the data obtained from the experiment of research to get the output. It may be in the graphical type, it may be in the graphical graphs, or it may be in the tabular form, or maybe the different types of chemical structures. Field of chemistry is vast. In further, there is a need of developing of software packages that would be useful in the field of chemistry. If a software engineer has the fundamentals of chemistry, it is easy to him or her to develop software to the acquired task. For the development of supercomputers, one must have the knowledge on chemistry also. Now moving on to the next one. That is ECE and EEE. We know that atom, and what is the most important part of an atom? It is nothing but the electron, proton, and neutron. But here we are talking about only the electrons. Electronics is nothing but the manipulation of electrons. I repeat, electronics is nothing but manipulation of electrons. One must know how to manipulate an electron. For the knowledge of chemistry, it is necessary, for instance, good knowledge on elements, its properties, valency of electrons, and so on. In short, chemistry helps ECE and EEE students in all aspects. Now moving on to mechanical department or mechanical branch. The pillars of mechanical engineering were made by the basic sciences, and we can see the role of chemistry everywhere in mechanical engineering. Starting from the fuels, you can say that without the fuel, there is no machine or vehicle runs. The efficiency, quality, and other properties of a fuel can be studied only with the help of a knowledge of chemistry. Mechanical engineer must know the material science that comprises of physics and chemistry. Means a combination, means knowledge of physics and chemistry is required for that. The properties of metals, alloys, composition, and its stability, reactivity, etc., that are related to chemistry. Now, moving on to civil engineering, like mechanical ECE, EEE, civil engineering also has a great significance of chemistry in engineering. It starts from manufacture of cement, making of concrete, selection of material for reinforcement. Chemistry of setting and hardening of cement decides the stability of it. To meet the challenges and the requirement of civil engineers for a construction can be made on the basis of chemical reaction occurring in the material incorporated. To know and develop the upcoming technologies in civil engineering, it is in a better way, knowledge of chemistry will be a great source of knowledge to a civil engineer. Now the next one which we'll see that whatever the things we have to learn it here, maybe before the college, means your daily classes will start, or the things what or you have enough time now also, just go through it, whatever you have done till now, means the things which you have learned, it is only just brush up it so that you can have the base. Minimum, the knowledge you have required for this one means you have to know about the engineering chemistry, in engineering chemistry in that whatever the batteries, the part of batteries you have learned, or before that one you can say that what is element, types of element and their properties and so on. Along with that, how the types of batteries, the different types of batteries which are there, different types of cells which are there, how it will be useful for that one. Atomic structure. For atomic structure, you must have to know that what is an atom. Second thing is there, what is an after the atom. Atom is made up of, as you know, the electron, proton and neutron. Its position, you can say, and its distribution and the different theories, whatever you have learned, just brush up it. Water and corrosion, we know that without the water there is no life, and here you will learn the many different parts of many different types of water, what is the bad effect of water and what is the types of water, means hardness, we can say that the temporary hardness and permanent hardness, and how does it affects and so on. Not only this one, you just learn about the organic chemistry. As we know that organic chemistry is a branch of chemistry which deals with carbon and hydrogen. Along with the carbon and hydrogen, it also deals with, means the compound which has prepared, it also made up of, along with the carbon, hydrogen and oxygen, sulfur, nitrogen and so on. The properties, here you have to learn, or you have to just go through it, what is the valency of carbon, how you will write the structure, what is the, you can say that alkane, alkene and alkynes, whatever you have learned in plus two level, or I can say that the intermediate first year and second year. The thing is there, if you have the knowledge, the basic knowledge, it is very easy for us to make a building, or you can say that to understand the chemistry very easily. Now the next part, whatever the branches of chemistry I have enlisted here, the branches of chemistry is nothing but the organic chemistry, inorganic chemistry, physical chemistry, biochemistry, analytical chemistry, and so on. As I said just now, organic chemistry, it is nothing but concerned with, or we are learning, organic chemistry is a branch of chemistry which deals with carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, sulfur, and so on. Inorganic chemistry, which is deals with the substances which are not considered to organic, means sometimes the carbon will be there, but not all. Along with that, which may contains hundreds of elements, including the carbon, you can say. The next one, you can say that the physical chemistry, It deals with the application of physical laws to chemical change and chemical system. Physical chemistry, what we are learning there, involvement of matter and energy. What happened when both combines, that maybe the different types of reactions as you have learned, exothermic reaction and endothermic reaction. From the word only, exo means given out, endo means absorb. Then the next comes to the biochemistry. It concerned with the chemistry of life, processes and living organism and so on. Next, analytical chemistry. It concerned mainly with the various techniques and the laboratory methods to determine the composition of matter. Now the next, it's very interesting, means here, what do a chemical engineers do? Which is nothing but the chemical engineering. Chemical engineers works in, maybe in the manufacturing, pharmaceuticals, design and construction, pulp and paper industries, petrochemicals, or food processing. As I said, the chemistry is everywhere and every area, you can say. Here just I have given more examples here, the types of energies which are there. Maybe it is the nuclear power plant or thermal power plant or the batteries, or you can say the dry cells. Next comes the mining and the minerals, or the nowadays it is the mining engineering is also there. What do we do? Extraction of the gold, copper, steel, diamond, coal, charcoal, and you can say that the fossil fuels also, along with that some other minerals too. As I said, the concept of green chemistry is new. The concept of green chemistry is new. The green chemistry is the utilization of a set of principle that reduces or eliminate the use or generate of hazardous substances in the design, manufacture and application of chemical products. In short, we have to design a chemical reaction in such a way that minimum byproduct will be formed, or no harmful gases are given out in the environment. Or in short, to sum up the green chemistry, I can say that the environmental friendly energy. The next I can say that, just see, whatever the chemical products are there, it is nothing but due to the knowledge of chemistry only. The chemical products which we are using at home, at daily, in our daily life, I'm just quoting here the few examples: sugar, then the all kind of sodas, cosmetics, oil, ghee, textile, leather industry, leather products, and the kind of different types of acids, and last but not least, you can say that it's a cleaning product. The cleaning, maybe you can say that the cleaning to the body, you can say, or the cleaning to the clothes and so on. Not only these things, along with that, we are using the chemicals or the chemical compounds as antibiotics and other medicines, fertilizers, pesticides, plastics, nylon, rayon, polyester, and other synthetic materials, gasoline, and other fuels. The last but not least, it is the water purification also. Now see, role of chemistry in society and for industry. As I said, industry depends on chemistry. Many professions and occupations need some knowledge of chemistry. The application of theories in chemistry produces new and better materials. everyday experience at home and the community are the explained by chemist only. Now see the career in chemistry. The chemist, or you can say that the person who learned the chemistry, can do the many types of jobs which are there. Few are highlighted here: law, education, pharmaceutical, toxicology, medicine, biochemistry, nanotechnologist, forensic science experts, maybe do the business, polymer, or learn about the different types of materials and so on. Now see, the careers in chemistry, maybe that person, he or she, related to the career in the health or the science profession, maybe in the teaching field, maybe in the career in the laws or the forensic science or entrepreneurship. This I complete the first PPT. Now I have to go for the second PPT, and in that we will see that how the chemistry is useful for in our daily life. Just stay with us. Now see, here I with different types of pictures, I will just sum up by seeing that chemistry in everyday life. Now see, I think it is very easy for you to understand now. What is chemistry? Chemistry is for community. Chemistry is for health. Chemistry is for environment. Chemistry is for medicine. Chemistry is for industry. Chemistry is for science. Chemistry is for teaching. And chemistry is for research. Last but not least, chemistry is for you only. Now see, the two quotes are there. These are not exactly the quotes, but here the chemistry is there. You just see. You can't force chemistry to exist where it doesn't. I repeat, you can't force chemistry to exist where it doesn't, in the same way you can't deny it when it does. Okay, the second one, two bodies in love with each other, in love deep within their beings, with every atom and cell and nerve and thought. Now, the same pictorial diagram, I can say that chemistry in everyday life is nothing but the human body, emotions, that is a chocolate and candy, fruit and veggies, blood, flame, art, and so on. Even try to think why a particular vegetables bears a particular color and taste. It has been founded that the sunlight is a beam of light, that is a white light, and when it is impact on an object, some of them get absorbed while the others are reflected back. The vegetables are green due to the presence of chemical compound named chromosphere. I repeat, the vegetables are green due to the presence of a chemical compound named chromosphere, which absorb all the wavelengths. Now see, chemistry and composition of human body. Now see, as we know that the different elements is starting from the hydrogen to the transition elements and the lanthanides and actinides. If suppose we will do the study, we can see that I have listed few on the right side, while the rest of thing, which is very rare, in the left hand side and the right hand side simultaneously. You can see that the chart is also there. The elements which are there, the oxygen, the percentage of oxygen in our body is 65%. Carbon is 18.5%, hydrogen is 9.5%, calcium 1.5% and so on. Along with that, you can see that the different elements which are there, tin, cadmium, aluminium, lead, beryllium, indium, I can say that our body is also made up of chemistry. Now, very interesting fact is there here. Chemistry in henna. Here, you have one compound known as lawsone, L-A-W-S-O-N-E-D-N-E. What is its structure? Two benzene rings joined together, oxygen which is there, that is a para position to each other, and the hydroxyl group is attached to it. Now see the beauty of this Lawson compound. The red orange dye from the leaves of the henna plant contained the Lawson. The Lawson reacts chemically with keratinin in the skin, which is present in our body, leaving a stain that lasts for 2 to 6 weeks. Another compound is there, PPD. It is nothing but para dianilene benzene. The black henna is red henna, which has a dye, which is nothing but the para phenyl diamine added to it. And because of that one, the colors you can see for the henna, the black henna. Now, next come to the chocolates. I will not go in detail about the what the compounds are there, but just see, whatever you eat, whatever you think, whatever you do, it is the reaction of the chemistry, I can say. Here the chocolates also, I mentioned it here, the different types of chocolates are there. It is a dark chocolate, milk chocolate, white chocolate, and so on. And the different types of compounds which are present over there. Now, chemistry and fruit and veggies, whatever we eat also, it is the chemicals, I can say in one way, because the compounds which are there, they are present. Just see the banana. In banana, we have the amyl acetate. In cherry, it is the amyl butyrate. In pineapple, amyl hexanate and so on. The next, periodic tables and the parts of our life. I am just giving a 1 minute, around 30 seconds to 1 minute. Just go through it and see how the chemistry plays an important role in our daily life and how the persons has arranged each and everything, whatever we are using in daily life. Just go through it by seeing the chart for the periodic table. Just go through it one after the another. Yeah, next comes chemistry in human emotion. Just like anger, or you can say here the different types of chemical substances are there. It is the dopamine, endorphine, oxytocin, estradiol, thyroxine and so on. It is nothing but which causes, means one, if they suppress, you have some another feeling. If you have increased that some chemical substances, you will have that. As we know that the basic emotions which we have is love, joy, anger, sadness, fear, and so on. Now the next is very interesting fact about the rain. That is chemistry and how it related with rain. Geosmin has a distinct earthy flavor and aroma and is responsible for the earthy taste of the beets and a contributor to the scent, that is a peculiar smell in the air. When rain falls, after a day, a spell of weather, it is produced a type of actinobacteria. See the structure, two benzenes ring is there, but it is not benzene, it is alternate bondings are not there. Now just see the chemistry of flame. Chlorine is common, or you can say the chloride is common in everywhere. But see the beauty of flame. If I will change the first name of the element, the first metal, just like starting for the lithium chloride, followed by the sodium chloride, see the changes of the flame. Potassium chloride, rubidium chloride, cesium chloride, calcium chloride, strontium chloride, barium chloride, copper chloride, and the last one is titanium chloride. Though the chloride, the second part in each compound is same, but by changing the first part, maybe you can say the element, the color of the flame changes simultaneously. And see, the chemistry is also in blood, and chemistry which you can also see in ice cream. And the last but not least, you can see a beauty of chemistry in art also. This, I conclude the today's session, as I hope I make you understand the basic sciences or basic principle of chemistry, which is related to in everyday life. Hope you enjoyed. As I said, if you have the time, just learn the basic things, just like how many elements are there, what is its position and how they react, what is its chemical properties, physical properties, and so on. Not only the elements, whatever the basic principles are there, once again I will tell you, means whatever is going on around you, just make a watch of that one and think what chemistry is going on around us. Let me conclude by saying this one. Okay, thank you. Thank you.
I would like to thank you very much, Dr. Rehana Anju, ma'am, who has highlighted the importance of chemistry. And let me tell you, students, that without chemical chemistry or mental chemistry, you cannot survive in any job. So better you adopted chemistry in a positive way in both the. I wish you all the best for dealing with chemistry, because the entire life depends on the combination of chemistry and chemistry between you and other people in the society. Before going to start the next session, I would like to make announcement. As you know that entire India is now supporting farmers, and due to Bandh, the Bharat Bandh, we are facing a little bit problem for the next signed schedule. That we had a guest lecture earlier from Manu University, and Dr. Asadullah sir was about to address you, but due to this sudden announcement of Bharat Bandh, he is unable to be with us. So therefore, inshallah, maybe tomorrow or day after tomorrow, we will be in touch with him and reschedule his slot. So, but in order to continue the other one, let's move to your mechanical engineering related to all fields, all branches. You will be surprised, mechanical engineering is a separate branch, madam. How can it be related? Let me tell you, in first year, you have to adopt the basics of mechanical engineering for any field, whether you adopt a CSE, whether you go for ECE, whether you go for AI, whether you go for civil engineering, but without this nuts and bolts, you cannot. So to make you familiar that what basic information related to this, okay, and how you can start your career, particularly in sense of mechanical engineering also, will help this upcoming two sessions to you. We have with us, as I have told you, the first presentation is about clean energy generating using fuel cell technology by our senior faculty, Mr. Sayyed Aslam, Professor of Mechanical Engineering Department. I would like to read his brief introduction to you so that you will understand which personality is going to address you. He is right now with us as a part of professor in the Department of Mechanical Engineering. And let me tell you, before this, he has been with us, with the Sister Cousin Association Institution of the same management, Farha College of Engineering. He has total experience of teaching 34 years, and he has taught 8 years for engineering institutions, and he worked for 26 years in research and development area as well as industries. And his specialization is fuel cell technologies along with renewable energy. And with this, I would like to introduce, and I request Sir, Professor Sayyed Aslam Sir, to address the gathering and enhance the students about the this chemical fuels and other technology related issues of mechanical engineering. Over to Sir.
First, thank you, madam, for introducing myself. Dear students, this is the first time I'm interacting with these first year students. You may not be knowing me, but I have been involved with sister college, Farha Institute of Technology. And now I am working in Lodge Institute of Technology. Right. So today, my today's lecture is related with clean energy generation using fuel cell technology. See, you may be saying that this is not related to your field, maybe CSC and IT students, but it is very much relevant with all the fields because it is an interdisciplinary field. So here I'll be focusing exclusively on fuel cell technology, but generally I will be just dealing with it. We know, just slide, first slide. We know how electrical power is generated. We have thermal power stations, we have hydro power stations, we have nuclear power stations, right? But in India, just I will be just focusing here. In India, we have 48% of thermal power stations. That means almost 50% we are using coal as a fuel. When we use coal as a fuel, then a lot of carbon emissions are emitted into the atmosphere. We know because of this carbon emissions, you know, our ozone layer is getting depleted and it is affecting the climate change. Recently also we have seen lot of rain in our twin cities and then it has damaged so many people houses also. So what I am saying is these, because of this change of climate and then how this is occurring because of the emissions into the atmosphere, and then these emissions are damaging the ozone layer. So that is why there is always erratic climates now. We don't have any control. Earlier we used to say our rainy season will be starting in the month of June, but now we are seeing rain very often, right? So that is why, because of the climatic changes also, right? Now here I just focused this thermal engineering. It is dealing with thermal production, right? That means we are converting chemical energy of the fuel. We have fossil fuel, you know, fossil, you have studied about fossil fuels. What are the fossil fuels? We have coal, we have petroleum, and we have natural gas. And we also know that they have the limited period. They are going to deplete in future. So we have to find out some renewable sources for that. That means some sustainable energy for this. So for this, we have to produce an electrical energy using some other renewable sources. So one of the technology which is using these renewable sources, we can take as fuel cell technology. So when we are using hydrogen as a fuel, then we are producing complete clean energy. I will show that. So let me, this is my presentation outline. First, I will be introducing to the introduction, what is happening in the world. Then, and I'll be not focusing in whole over India, but I will just give the statistics which is happening in our twin cities, that is Hyderabad and Secunderabad. I will take the example of automobiles which are plying in these twin cities. And then I will just try to explain what is the importance of fuel cell to that. Then can you show that, sir? Now, see, now we know that our world is going down because of rising prices of these fossil fuels. We know that it is also depleting. Then one more, there is lot of increase in vehicles, right? Now, millions of these two-wheelers and four-wheelers, which are run by internal combustion engines, they are polluting the air or atmosphere. So because of that, we are having lot of health issues also. We have having lot of problems also. So most of the people, they get affected with breathing problems. I have given that they will be attacked by asthma or bronchitis, and possibly finally it may lead to cancer also. And one more important part, the average lifespan of people is also getting reduced because of this pollution, because we are inhaling pollution everywhere where we are going. And one more important, the public movement in the twin cities is also getting affected. We don't want to go out, I mean, in the at 5 o'clock or 4 o'clock, because a lot of crowd will be there having these vehicles running there. So next, right. So this is a statistics which I have shown. See, in June 2019 itself, we have, you can see that total vehicles which are plying in twin cities, this is an example of twin cities only, almost 56,000 vehicles, two wheelers, four wheelers are plying in these twin cities. Out of that, you can see more than 45,000 are two wheelers and more than 10,000 are four wheelers, right? Next. Right. Now, this pollution, it is these vehicles which are plying in the twin cities, they are causing lot of pollution. You can see what are the pollution which is emitted into the atmosphere. You see, carbon monoxide emission itself is more than 2/3. That is, more than 61% is carbon monoxide, and then hydrocarbon contribution is 34%. And then you can see even lead, which is actually affecting the young children, is also emitted into the atmosphere, because we are using the pollution. We are not able to control the pollution because we are using these IC engines, where we are combusting our diesel as well as petrol. And then that is leading to this pollution which is emitted into the atmosphere. Right, next. Then, you can see here, I have given the statistics saying that the officials say that these vehicles, two wheelers and four wheelers, may be crossing around 60 lakhs in the coming, by the end of this 2020. Right, next. Now, why I have given this lecture is to make aware the engineering community about the clean energy generation using one of the technology which is called as fuel cell technology. Right. Now, there is urgent, we have to face the problem and solve this problem using the available technologies. One technology is electric batteries, and second one is fuel cell technology. We can use electric batteries also in your automobiles, but the problem is the range of the vehicle cannot be more than 40 or 50 kilometers. We can run only 40 to 50 kilometers, then you have to recharge the battery, and then charging will take place, take around 8 to 10 hours for complete charging. Whereas you come to fuel cell technology will be generating electric power continuously as long as fuel and oxidant will be supplied, right? So here, the range is not limited. So we can, suppose if you fill the tanks in a fuel cell electric vehicle, then you can run the automobile or car for almost 500 to 600 kilometers without any refilling. So that is the beauty of this technology. And then I will say why we are going for this fuel cell technology. Then clearly I have given fuel cell technology. It is the cleanest and most efficient. Excuse me. we know that it is going to deplete in future. So now our option is sustainable energy. So we call renewable energy as sustainable energy. What are the renewable energy? We have solar energy, we have wind energy, right? But they are erratic. They are renewable energy. If you generate electrical power using these two energies, sources of energy, solar, and because solar is available only from the morning to evening, whereas wind also is erratic. Suppose if you generate that electrical power and store it somewhere, then we can use it for future use. So now, if you generate from solar energy, if you generate hydrogen, hydrogen is the cleanest fuel. It is available on the earth, not as separately hydrogen, but it is available as hydrocarbon. It is available in hydrocarbons, or it is available in water. We know what is the formula of water. We know it is H2O. That is, water is a compound of hydrogen and oxygen element, right? So now suppose if you split this water into hydrogen and oxygen using the solar energy or wind energy, then we call it as a renewable energy source. So now this hydrogen is an energy carrier. You can store the hydrogen in storage tanks or as a liquid nitrogen, and then you can supply it to wherever you like. So similarly, this hydrogen, which is stored in the hydrogen tanks, can be used in our fuel cell. So we call that as hydrogen fuel cell or proton exchange membrane fuel cell, because fuel cell which is working on pure hydrogen is nothing but it is proton exchange membrane fuel cell. Right, sir. Next. Now, I want to give the definition of a fuel cell. Fuel cell also is similar to a battery, right? Fuel cell is an electrochemical converter which converts chemical energy of the fuel directly into electrical energy. That is the beauty. So there is one stage, that means from chemical energy directly to electrical energy. That is the reason why the efficiency of fuel cell is quite high. It is compared to other power generating technologies, fuel cell has maximum efficiency, right? Then next, right, this conversion of fuel to electrical energy takes place via electrochemical process, not combustion. We are not combusting. I'll tell you, it is a clean. Why it is a clean? That because we are converting it from electrochemical directly to electrical energy. So we are not combusting, we are not burning the fuel, right? So it is a clean, quiet, and highly efficient process, and it is more efficient than fuel burning like petrol or diesel. And one more important point, the energy density of hydrogen is 3 times as petrol, right? So that is the important, that is why the efficiency of hydrogen fuel cell is quite high. Sir, next. Right, here I have shown the energy transformation for electrical energy output. You can see fuel cell from chemical to directly electrical energy. And then battery also, it is chemical to electrical energy. I told you what is the disadvantage of battery, because after maybe around 50 or 60 kilometers, again you have to recharge the battery. But here in fuel cell, we can run the automobile as long as fuel and oxidant are supplied. So now you come to heat engine. Heat engine means your petrol engine and diesel engine. How the conversion is taking place? Suppose if you are converting chemical energy of diesel into electrical energy, these are the steps which are involved. From chemical, we convert it into heat energy, and from again heat energy, we use a piston connecting rod and crank mechanism to convert heat energy into mechanical energy. And then from mechanical energy, when we connect the shaft to an electrical generator, we get electrical energy. So now so many stages are involved here. So at every stage, there is friction losses taking place. That is why the efficiency when it comes out as an electrical energy is quite low. Right, next. All right, here I have shown you the efficiencies of the power generating systems. You can see here, you see this gasoline electrical, suppose if you are using petrol or diesel engine to generate electrical power, you can see the efficiency is quite low. It may be from 10% to 30%, right? Suppose if you go to diesel electric, then you get from 30 to 35% as an efficient. That is, what is efficiency? Efficiency is nothing but it is output by input. Suppose if you are giving 100 units as input, then you get 30% unit as output. So that is the efficiency. So for diesel engine, if you are using diesel engine for generating electrical energy, then the efficiency is only 30%. Whereas you come to fuel cell, you can see it is starting from 40% and then it is reaching around 65%. So that is why the fuel cell efficiency is quite high. As I showed you, it is a single state conversion. That means from heat energy, from chemical energy, directly we are converting it into electrical energy. Then you can see one more, steam and gas turbines also, its efficiency is around from, it will be varying from 30% to 40%. And on the horizontal line, he has given the power output, what is the maximum unit we can develop out of this. So gasoline, electric power we can generate from up to maybe around 100 kilowatt. For diesel, we can go up to 1000 kilowatt electrical generator. For fuel cell, we have, you can see that it is more than 10,000 kilowatt or in megawatts, we can generate electrical power using this fuel cell in stationary power. Okay, next. Now, as I told you, fuel cell is nothing but it is similar to a battery, but in battery, chemical reactants are kept inside the battery, whereas in fuel cell, these chemicals, hydrogen and oxygen from air, we supply from outside. So as long as this fuel and air is supplied to the fuel cell, it will be generating electrical power. That is the duty. Okay, next. And then as long as fuel cell will be producing, see, the output of the fuel cell is electrical energy, electrical power, and byproduct is water. It is water and a small amount of heat. So this is there is no pollutants. There is no zero emission. We call, that is why fuel cell vehicles run by hydrogen using fuel cell technology are known as zero emission vehicles. Zero emission. There is no emission. So what is the emission? It is only water vapor which will be coming out. Okay, right. Next. The diagram will come, sir. Next, just click. Click. Right. Here, this is a schematic of a proton exchange membrane fuel cell operation. You see, as I told you, it is similar to a battery. We have studied about batteries. Battery, any battery consists of three components. One is anode, second one is cathode, and third one is electrolyte. Similarly, here also, we have anode, cathode, and electrolyte. And then, but as I told you, the fuel has to be supplied from outside. So here, suppose if you are using a hydrogen, pure hydrogen as a fuel, then it is supplied on the anode, and then on the cathode, oxygen from air will be supplied on the cathode. So the half reaction, half chemical reaction which is taking place on the anode, when we are supplying hydrogen on the anode, then hydrogen splits into protons and electrons. It is electrochemically, it is splitting, anode will be splitting hydrogen atom or hydrogen molecule into electrons and protons. We know that electrons, supply of movement of electrons is known as electricity. That is, so electrons which are splitted on the anode, they will pass through the external load, or it can pass through the motors to supply load. Then protons which have been split, that will be passing through the electrolyte. The function of the electrolyte is to supply only ions, that is proton. Proton is a positive ion. It will be diffusing through the electrolyte only. It cannot pass through the external circuit, and electrons cannot pass through the electrolyte. So that is the function of the electrolyte. It will allow only protons to pass through it. So now electrons through external circuit and then protons through the electrolyte, it will be combining on other electrode, that is cathode, where we are supplying oxygen from air. So when oxygen, protons and electrons combine, they form water. That is the final product which we get from the fuel cell. We get electricity generation as well as pure water when we are supplying hydrogen as a fuel. And then some amount of heat also will be generated. Okay, right, next. Right, this is about same thing. Right, next. Right, next. Right, now a single individual fuel cell will be generating around, depending on the area of the cell. So the potential difference between the two electrodes will be around 1.2 volts theoretical, but we can say 1 volt will be generated. Suppose we want a 12 volt fuel cell, then we connect the cells in series to generate that much power. Right now, so this is how we classify the fuel cell, because we generate electrical voltage as well as current. So this is a polarization curve between shown for a simple cell. Come on, next. This is a power. Next. Right. So how can fuel cell technology be used? As I told you, all major automobile industries, no, they are working, such as Honda, Toyota, Hyundai, and others also, they are working with to make fuel cell vehicles. We call it with hydrogen as a fuel to commercialize a fuel cell car. Now, as of June, this is a statistics, as of June 2018, we have more than 6,500 fuel cell vehicles sold to the consumers in various countries, in US, Japan, right, in European countries. Then we can say that by 2020, they said, this fuel cell vehicle will be commercialized. Okay. Then we can say more than 2,500 fuel cell systems have been installed all over the world in hospitals, nursing homes, hotels, office buildings as auxiliary power. Right. And then in telecommunications also, where we require continuous supply of power, again, fuel cell technology is being used there, right? We can say, sir, see now, this consumer electronics also, they are using this fuel cell technology to charge the battery of these laptops. In future, we will see that fuel cell technology will be charging the battery. Now we have lithium ion batteries in these laptops, but in future we will see that it will be operated by fuel cell power. And then even cell phones, now see, after 1 or 2 hours or 4 hours of continuous use, your cell phone get discharged. But suppose if you are using fuel cell technology for more than 20 hours, you don't need any charging. Right. Next. Then, as I told you, as I have shown also in that graph also, this fuel cell generation, it gives the maximum efficiency. So electrical, you can say 40 to 50% efficiency you can get, and some heat is also generated. Suppose for high temperature fuel cells, if you are using the heat also for some other cogeneration purposes, then the efficiency can reach up to 60 to 65%. Next. Right. So what are the benefits? As I told you in the beginning itself, the benefits of using fuel cell technology is, first one, to reduce the pollution, which is the very pandemic case in all over the world. Now, this pollution can be completely eliminated if we are using fuel cell technology. Right. Next, sir. Right. But what are the challenges? Now, why I want these budding engineers to understand this technology? Because this is the technology which will be used in future. And then, because I told you it is a renewable energy, we can say it comes under renewable energy and then sustainable energy, right? But here, what is the problems we are facing here? Now, you can see the cost of fuel cell must be reduced to compete with conventional technologies. I have given one statistics also. Presently, for generating 1 kilowatt, we have to spend around $300 per kilowatt. Whereas conventional IC engines, right, like petrol engine and diesel engine, they can generate 1 kilowatt at $35, right? Then, to be competitive, if you want to make it competitive with the conventional energy sources, then the cost has to be reduced to around $30 per kilowatt. The work is going on there. Now, right now, fuel cell vehicle, which is there in the market, it cost around $50,000. That is around 33 lakhs, right? But why? One more important point is, now these vehicles are not mass produced. It is produced in hundreds only. Now, suppose if you produce in mass, maybe around 1 lakh or 10 lakh vehicles, automatically the cost of the vehicles will be coming down. When anything is mass produced, then automatically the cost will be coming. These are the hindrances I am showing. What are the challenges which we are facing right now here? I have shown here. Then durability of the fuel cells also have to be improved. Right. Next, sir. Right. Okay. I want to thank our principal and our first year dean and Nusrat Fatima madam for giving me this opportunity for presenting my paper. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Aslam sir. I hope that why this advancement lecture has been given to you, so that, as I told yesterday also, that if you set a goal to achieve something in future, then you start working towards it. Since it is the beginning, the first step of your engineering, therefore this advancement is showing that how engineering is so vast. This latest technology, if you focus, if you work on it, you can prove yourself best or set a mark. Now, next session is purely about your subject in first year, which is known as engineering workshop, manufacturing, and graphics and all. That means these two subjects you are going to write in examination. You have exams, you have practicals about it. And it is good. This subject is being dealt by mechanical department. So our next speaker, Mohammad Misbahuddin, assistant professor of mechanical engineering, is going to highlight you about this particular subjects. About his brief profile, I would like to tell you that he has qualification of DME, and he has done BE in mechanical engineering and M.Tech in MD, and he is pursuing a PhD from APJK University of Indore, APJ Abdul Kalam University of Indore. And he has published 20 technical papers in both international and national journals, and he has published 2 books for Usmania and JNTU as well. The topics were engineering mechanics and engineering graphics. So without, because already my time is passing out fast, so I would like to invite Ms. Basar to address you the subject related to first year. So over to Ms. Basar.
Yes. Thank you, madam, for giving me the opportunity to speak over this topic. So myself, Mohammad Misbahuddin, I am the assistant professor in mechanical engineering department. So now I am going to highlight the subject. So engineering workshop is one of the lab for all branches, including civil, mechanical, electronics and communication engineering, computer science engineering. So for all these branches, this engineering workshop and engineering graphics is compulsory. Everybody engineers have to go through this. So our topic is workshop and manufacturing process and engineering graphics. These two subjects are correlated with each other. So we have to get the idea of engineering graphics and design, then only we can go for engineering workshop practices. So this subject is not only for mechanical, it is useful for all branch students. It may be civil, computer science, electronics, and petroleum engineering also, because for manufacturing a product, so few people will say, what is the use of the engineering workshop for computer science and for electronics engineering? Let us take an example of electronics engineering. For electronics engineering, take an example of the PLC circuit, PLC box. So it should be made by the metals. Means if it is a metal, then we have to go for sheet metal. Then few machine component or few electronic component, few computers has to be set in a wooden box, or it is to be kept in some metallic box. Then that computer engineer has to give the suggestion, has to design the component, have to design the object, have to design the box depending upon their criteria. Sir. Next. So in this our manufacturing process, every first year engineers, every first year student has to undergo this workshop practice. In theory, we are studying all those things, but to get the complete knowledge, so every engineer has to do the different task in our workshop practice.
we have different branches, we have different sectors in our engineering workshop. So first, engineering workshop is useful for all our engineering students. It gives the idea, if you are making the model, it may be a metallic, it may be a wooden, which type of wood we have to choose. If you are using a metal, which kind of metal to be used for the particular object, for the particular case. Not only we are giving the idea, we are explaining how to do the, how to perform the experiment, how to get the object done. So now we have a different trades in this. First one is a carpentry shop, fitting shop, plumbing, electrical shop, sheet metal shop, and as well as a welding shop. So our first is carpentry. In carpentry, first of all, we will teach what is the application of different, what kind of material, what kind of wood we have to choose for our intended purposes. We can see carpentry is surrounded by our environment. Daily purpose equipment, it may be a chair, it may be a different equipment we are seeing in our surroundings. Apart from this, this carpentry, this daily uses equipment, we are preparing a different box in which we have to keep the electronic devices, we have to keep the some servers, some different electronic object we are keeping in an electronic box. So depending upon the atmosphere condition, we have to choose the wood. We have different types of wood. Next. Yeah. So we have different types of wood, teak wood, mango wood, chisham wood, as well as kale and the patal. Here now we are training the student how to join the, how to perform the operation on a different wooden piece and how to assemble them for getting a useful product. Okay, so here we are, our student are have to perform different operation. That is, first one is preparation of half lap joint and mortise and tenon joint. Here student will learn what is lap joint and what is butt joint. So same thing we are studying in our sheet metal also. As well as a fitting section, we have to undergo the butt joint as well as lap joint. And also in case of welding, we have to go through the what is butt joint and lap joint. Means we are, when we are welding the specimen, we are welding in a different forms. So now we are, there are different equipment we are using in a carpentry too. So first of all, we are choosing a carpentry vise and we are fixing the wooden piece, and then we are going for cutting the wooden piece according to our requirement. According to our requirement, we are cutting the piece by using a hacksaw. Now, before cutting, we have to choose the different things like a divider and like a compass. By using compass, we are giving the curve shapes, and we are using a marking tools also. So there are the different carpentry tools which are useful for, which are useful in performing the object and performing the making the models, we can say. So after placing over the vise, surface may not be smooth, surface has to be smooth. Then what to do? We are using the different devices. Let us take a metallic jack as well as a wooden jack. By using this, we are making the surface smooth. If the surface is rough, some few components require rough surfaces, few components require smooth surfaces. Smooth surfaces give the surface finish and give the good appearance to the component. Okay, so there, so we have different devices. By using these devices, by using metallic jack, by using the wooden jack, we are smoothening the surfaces. So now for removing the unwanted material, for removing the unwanted wood and giving the shape to the wood, we are using the different chisels and we are using the tenon saw, cross cut saw, different saw we are using for cutting the specimen, okay, and for removing the material from the wooden piece. Sometimes we have to make a groove, it may be a circular, it may be a rectangular groove. We have to make from the we have to make the groove in a wooden piece. Then we have to use this equipment so that we can drill the object, drill the wood, and we can get the required object. So these are the different joints. The first one I would like to highlight, butt joint. Second one is dowel, dad or rabbit, and lap joint. So now we are explaining how to make the object, how to make this joint, and how to assemble it. So before this, before doing the operation, we are explaining how to choose the particular material, which kind of wood is suitable for so and so application. Okay, so later we are telling how to perform this operation, how to make this joint. We are explaining the techniques to perform this kind of joints. Okay, now next one is a fitting. Fitting is useful for mechanical as well as for all engineering branches. It may be electronic, it may be electrical, it may be computer science. Let us take an example of the computer science. We are keeping a server in the different servers in a trays, and we are making the different portion, and that we are placing here. For that placing our servers, we have to fix the columns, we have to fix the object with each other, and then we can place the object. So fitting section not only used for civil mechanical, it may be useful for electrical as well as computer science application. By using in this fitting, what we are doing, we are removing the material. First of all, we are marking the material. If we want to remove the hole, then we are marking. If we want to cut the specimen, we want to make the V joint, if we want to make the circular joint, then we are marking the particular sheet, we are marking the particular material piece of specimen, and then we are cutting according to our given shape. So different experiment has to be performed by the student. It may be V joint or dowel joints. So in this fitting section, we will say which kind of material is suitable for performing this operation. Okay, for making the model. Nowadays, we can see fitting section is also useful in bus body fabrication, car fabrication. Not only bus body and car fabrication, we are using this metallic specimen to prepare electrical towers. Not only electrical towers, now nowadays in our surrounding, we are seeing the tower for electronics. The telecommunication towers also we are seeing. So those towers are made in a fitting section. We will tell the technique how to cut the specimen and how to join and how to perform the experiment. Okay. So these are the different devices. We have to hold the equipment in a bench wise, and then by using the different, we have to, for checking the their dimensions, we are using the vernier caliper and different tri-squares we are using, and for a small object we are using the C-clamp. If you want to hold the small object, then we are holding the object in a C-clamp, and then we are performing the operation. Operation in the sense, we are drilling the hole, cutting the specimen, and then if the surfaces are, after cutting, if the surfaces are rough, then we are using the different files. By using the file, we are removing the unwanted material and we are making the surfaces smooth. So these are the different devices we are using in our carpentry to perform the particular operation. The next one. So now, just before I told you, so we are using the different tools. It may be file. We have the different file, square file, triangular file, round file, half round file. Depending upon our use, depending upon our intended purposes, we are using these files. Sometimes surfaces to be sharp, sometimes the corner to be made sharp. So in that case, we are using a triangular file. Sometimes the surface, after cutting the specimen, sometimes the surfaces should be round. For making the surfaces round, and smooth, we are using the half round file. Next one is, we are using a drill bit also. We are using the radial drilling machine for drilling the hole. After making the hole, what we are doing, we are enlarging the hole. Sometimes we have to enlarge the hole. We are using boring tool. Sometimes we have to do the surface finishing for the particular hole section. For that reason, we are using the reamers. The reamer is a process of making the smoothness of the hole which you have made in a particular specimen. Next one is plumbing. Plumbing, we are related with the pipes which are connected with each other. It is useful for transferring the liquid from one place to another place. Not only liquid, we are using this, we are connecting the pipe for transferring the gases also. There are different types of gases are available in our atmosphere. So those, it may be argon gas, it may be helium gas, it may be LPG, it may be CNG. So those gas has to be transmitted from one place to another place. For transmitting the gas from one place to another place, it requires a medium. So now the medium is a pipe. Through this pipe, we are transferring the liquid from one place to another place. So here this plumbing section, these pipes are incorporated with the, here the pipes are incorporated with the few devices. It may be pressure control valve, it may be flow control valve. Sometime the pressure of the fluid, it has to be controlled, it has to be regulated. So for regulating and controlling the flow rate of the particular fuel, it may be petrol, diesel, kerosene, water, okay, whatever it may be. So for controlling that, we are using the different pressure controlling and regulating valves. So here in plumbing section, we require less equipment as compared to fitting section and carpentry. In carpentry and fitting section, we required many number of tools. But in this case, we require only few tools. It may be a hacksaw, pipe cutter, thread cutting, and pipe vise. So only 4 to 5 tools we are using for performing the particular operation. So these are the cases where we are transferring the liquid, we are transferring the gases from one place to another places, and we are seeing the different valves are incorporated with the system. Okay, so along with the valve, we are having the measuring system. How many liters of petrol, diesel is passing from the pipe per minute, per second, we can calculate very easily. So same example we are seeing in our GHMC water connection. We are seeing the how many liters of water we are consuming per day. So like this, same devices we are using in our workshop practice. So next one is a tin smithy. So tin smithy means, for example, if we want to make a funnel, if we want to make a glass, if we want to make a one of the tray, so we are choosing the particular material, we are choosing the particular sheet. First of all, depending upon our requirement, we are choosing the sheet. If we want to make the funnel, if we want to make the tray, what kind of material to be selected? What kind of material to be selected? And then we have to, then our student will learn how to do the fabrication of the particular sheet, how to cut the sheet according to the given shape. So here we will teach how to develop the surfaces, how to cut the surfaces, and how to join the surfaces. We will explain the different techniques so that we can get a useful product in the form of a different shape object. It may be a funnel, tray, it may be a shell, different shape object we can fabricate depending upon our technique. So there are different techniques so same technique we are studying in engineering graphics also. So whatever we are learning in engineering graphics, okay, so same thing we can apply in our engineering workshop practice. So this is one of the application of the tin smithy. It is useful for fabrication of bus. We can use for bus body fabrication, side vault, and roof, and the front wall as well as the rear wall. All the walls are fabricated by the sheet. So we can say it comes under tin smithy. So now you are observing some structure. You are observing here some structure. It is done by a fitting section. In fitting section, what we are doing, we are taking the metallic specimen and we are cutting, depending upon our requirement, depending upon our height, we are cutting the specimen and then we are doing the welding operation. After once the structure is completed, then we are going for fab, we are spreading, then we are going for spreading the sheet across the structure. Okay, so not only this bus body fabrication, we are using this tin smithy in our PLC paneling section also. This tin smithy is useful for civil, mechanical, triple E, in all branches we can say. So this is a panel. It is prepared by a process that is the tin smithy. We are choosing the material depending upon our working condition. Sometime here in a circuit, the temperature may be maximum. So depending upon our temperature requirement, which kind of material we have to choose for making a panel. So this is an example of PLC training panel. Here student will learn how to make the component by using this pan, this tin smithy. So next is welding. So we have different types of welding in our workshop practice: TIG welding, MIG welding, arc welding, and oxyacetylene welding. Depending upon our condition, depending upon our material, we are going to choose the welding process. Welding is a process of joining the two similar and dissimilar material with or without the application of heat. Sometime we want to join the two similar, sometime we want to join the two dissimilar material. So for joining these two similar and dissimilar material, we are choosing the different welding process. It may be a TIG welding, TIG welding, MIG welding, oxyacetylene welding, or electric arc welding. Depending upon the material and operating condition, we are choosing the different welding process. Now, so till now we have studied the different manufacturing process, different sections, different section we have studied. One is carpentry, fitting, and next one is plumbing, and next we have studied tin smithy. So these are the different different portion each and every engineer has to perform these experiments. Now, so engineering graphics or engineering drawing. Drawing is a language of engineer. So nowadays in the market we are seeing a different component. In our daily life, it is incorporated with the many objects, many machines. So once the idea is developed by the company, then it has to be proved in the form of drawing, in the form of object. Let us take an example of a car. If you want to model a car, if you want to model a different component of the car, it may be gear, it may be a piston, cylinder. So depending upon our requirement, depending upon our load, it may be a two-wheeler piston, it may be a four-wheeler, it may be a car, bus, it may be a whatever it may be. So depending upon our requirement, we are going for modeling. Okay. So the application of engineering graphics is, so we can say this is related to mechanical component. Different complicated and intricate portion parts can be manufactured by using a graphic tools. So next application is civil engineering. Here we can construct, first of all, we can make the plan, and over the given plan, we can construct the walls, and we can give the desired shape to the different walls. Along with the walls, we can give the different shapes, different colors also. So this is the next application of civil engineering. So these are the different tools we are using in our engineering graphics. Our first two units we are doing over the on a over the drawing board, and then remaining four modules we have to do by using a AutoCAD. So the first tool is a drawing board. Next, we are using a mini drafter, triangular triangles, and T squares. So nowadays only we are using the mini drafter. If the size of the drawing is large, then only we are going for the T squares. So these are different tools which we are using. Each and every student has to bring this component, these pencils, HB, 2H, 4H pencils, and along with the adhesive tape. So different scales, each engineering student has to bring to the practice session. So we are using rollers for drawing the parallel lines. If you draw one parallel line, if you want to get the similar parallel line, then we are using a roller. So now drawing clips and circle template. Drawing clips are useful when we are, first of all, what we are doing, we are placing a drawing board over the place, over the drawing board, we are spreading a drawing sheet. For holding the drawing sheet, we are using the drawing clips. Each engineering student has to bring this. Now, next one is what we are learning in our engineering graphics. So first of all, we will draw the object. We will draw the object. It may be a circular object. It may be a straight object. Okay. Depending upon our requirement, we are drawing here. So first of all, let us take it. The object is circular. If the object is 360 degree, what will be the angle of that particular? How we are measuring the angle? If we want to place a few to five to six point over the circle, then how to place the circle? How to place the particular point over different angles? It may be the angle may be at 30 degree, 40 degree. Okay, so like this, we will explain the technique how to draw the objects. So these are the object we have drawn by using different commands, line command and circle command. And then we are joining the different lines, and finally we got a useful product. And this product has to give the names. Different components are there. So it may be a central line, it may be a dimensioning line. We have to dimension the object. So now in our first two modules, the first two modules deal with the practical drawing by hand. So in our first module, that is conic section, we will study the circle, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola. Let us take an example of a cone, circular cone. We are cutting the cone parallel to the base, then we will get a circular object. If you are taking a cone and cutting the object at some angle, then we are getting an ellipse. If you are cutting an object perpendicular to the base, we are getting a triangle. If you are cutting the object at offset distance from the axis, then we are getting the hyperbola. So how to develop the given object, how to develop the given shape? It may be ellipse. So let us take an example of a cone of a base diameter 100 mm and height 200 mm. If I'm cutting the cone parallel to the base, what will at some height from the base, what will be the shape? That shape can be drawn by using a different techniques. We have a different techniques in our engineering graphics. So similarly, ellipse parabola also can be drawn by the same. We have the different techniques how to draw the ellipse and the parabola. So finally, we are getting the shape of the ellipse parabola. So this is one of the technique how to develop the ellipse fugue. Now we are seeing there are different components in our machines. So all components may not be of same shape. It may be a circular one. Some component may be a elliptical type. Few component may be so for making the different object, we are using the different techniques. So this is one of the method how to draw the ellipse. Now next one is our second module is start with the projection of solids. We are taking the different solid, we have the different shapes, object, we are keeping the object over the ground and we are seeing how it looks front and top. So different prisms and parameters you will study, different object prisms, triangular, square, pentagonal, hexagonal. If you are keeping over the ground, how it looks from the front and how it looks from the top. Same, we are tilting the object. We are tilting triangular, square, pentagonal, hexagonal prism to a some angle and we are seeing from the front how it looks from the front and how it looks from the top and also how it looks from the side. Next is the pyramid. So similarly, we have triangular, square, pentagonal, hexagonal pyramid. So we are placing over the ground and we are seeing from the front how it looks from the front and how it looks from the top. And after tilting to a some angle with HP and VP, horizontal plane and vertical plane, how it looks. So these all things we will study in our second module by using AutoCAD. So next one, see, this is the pentagonal prism. We are keeping at a some angle over the ground, means one of the base. It is resting with one of the base. This is the top view and next we can see how it looks from the front. Now what I am doing, I am tilting the object at a some angle. So here you see the object is tilting at an angle of 45 degree, how it looks from the front. Same, after tilting, we can visualize from the top. So the second position shows how it looks from the top. Sometimes what we are doing, after tilting, sometimes the object has to be rotated to the some angle. Once we are rotating, how it looks in the top and how it looks from the front, we can visualize very easily. So these are the different techniques we will study in our engineering graphics. And same techniques we will apply in our engineering workshop practices. Okay, so with this, I will conclude my topic. Okay, thank you.
Misba sir, I hope the students who are the other side, hope this session is helpful to you, that what are the subjects are waiting here for you to deal with in engineering, especially in first year. So with this, I would like to conclude that with the thanks to Misba sir and mechanical engineering and chemistry department people. And tomorrow we are going to deal with the English department. And also, we are trying to invite or reschedule Asadullah sir's lecture on chemistry. Hope I will circulate the tomorrow's schedule also, what are the changes happen just because of this Bharat Band. Thank you very much. Till that time, till tomorrow, stay fit, healthy, okay, and be in touch with us. Allah Hafiz.